Hi, you're watching a video series on schema stitching, and in this first installment, we're going to be talking about this documentation page on combining schemas, which is sort of the most basic use of schema stitching. The files that we're going to be looking at are in this repository, Schema Stitching Demos, and we're going to be starting out with this example one here, which is combining local and remote schemas. So, if we were to go into our repo here, you can see we've got the index here. We're actually going and setting up a stitch schema. We'll be talking about that in a bit. And it's going to be bringing in several different services. So this is kind of the fundamental use of schema stitching, is to go and take multiple underlying subservices. In this case, we've got four of them. We've got subschemas, one, two, three, and four. And each of these are coming from different places. In this case, we've got three different remote services that we're going to be talking to, and then one local schema that comes in just from the local repository. So you can see in this package, we've got services grouping. We've got a local schema. This is just a simple executable schema that has just error codes and then just returns these directly. So this would be something that is maybe a utility that we don't necessarily need a dedicated service for, but we want to include in our API. So we'll just be taking this small snippet of schema and putting it directly into our combined stitched schema. Then we've got this product service over here. Products is a very small schema. It's got one type inside of it. Product has a name, price, and UPC, which is like an ID, and then one method to go and fetch products. Then we've got our storefront schema over here, which is also a very small schema. We've got a storefront. It's got an ID, a name, one method to go and get storefronts out, and then this SDL method, which we'll talk about in a few minutes. So overall, that's kind of the scope of the individual services that we're looking at. And then we're going to be looking at how these underlying services can be brought together into one unified gateway schema. So let's get started. We're going to start by firing up our subservices. And if we go and we check, we've got a graphical instance available for each of these. Okay, so this is looking at on 4001 is the product schema. So we can query for a couple sample products. There's a toothbrush. Product one was a cookbook. And then where this data is coming from is simply just a array inside of the subservice implementation. So there's no database here. These are just using just fixture arrays that we're going to be reading records out of. So we've got our product schema, and then we've got on 4002, we've got our storefront schema. So we can see storefront one is the product store, and two is eShop. So these by themselves are individual servers running GraphQL with their own discrete, very small schema portions. And then lastly, we'll come back and we'll fire up in a new tab. We're going to start the gateway. Okay, gateway is running on localhost 4000. And we'll go over to our gateway. Okay, and so in the gateway, we'll run this query, and here you can see we can actually go and get a product. We can get this Rainforest product, which we'll talk about in a minute. It's a variant of the product API. We can get a storefront, or we can get those error codes. And all of these things are fully interactive, going to their respective subservices. We're actually, as opposed to one server that's running all of these remote schemas, we're taking them all and building one proxy that's going and delegating requests live down to the underlying services. So let's look at the stitching code that does that. So when we actually make a stitch schema, the most basic thing that we need to give it are subschemas. And so each subschema is a configuration object which needs at least a schema, and then additional options that we'll be going through over the course of various examples. In this example, we're just going to be looking at this executor option and this transforms option down here. And so an executor is something that we need to go and create whenever we're doing a remote schema. So for example, this local schema down here, we've taken directly imported it into our gateway as a local import right here. And then we can just pass it straight in as a schema inside of the Stitch gateway, and it needs no executor because it's just going to be run as part of the Stitch schema. But these other remote servers actually need an executor function built for them, because this is going to be the thing that goes and proxies a request over to a remote server and gets a response back. So if we're to actually look at the implementation of this, this is a very simple function. It simply is setting up a async method that goes and receives a document that we want to fetch from the remote and variables that we're going to send it. It formats the document as a string. Then using some kind of fetch library, we're using crossfetch here, simply makes a post request, gets JSON, sends the query and the variables as the fetch body, and then just returns the JSON response. So using that little make remote executor helper there, you can see we've set up functions that are going to be fetching against our products service, our storefront subservice, and then this Rainforest API. Let's pretend we're doing a remote product database themed after a rainforest. We're going to say, in this example, we're actually using the same product server that we had before. We're going to pretend this Rainforest API is something we can't control. It's a third party, and we're going to look at it from the standpoint of possibly a third party schema that we want to bring in might conflict with one of our own. Obviously, Rainforest is going to conflict with the product's schema because they are literally the same thing. So we're going to use some tricks to go and make this remote that we don't control change its naming a little bit so that we can go and integrate it seamlessly around other names that we're already using inside of our API. Okay, so for actually building the schema fields here, we need to go and get just GraphQL schema instances. And there's a couple ways that we can do that when we're talking to a remote service. And one of the simplest ways is to use this utility from GraphQL Tools, the wrap package. It's called Introspect Schema. And introspection is a way to go and print out all of the characteristics inside of the schema. It's really, basically, if you ever go and open up this docs panel inside of one of your APIs, introspection is actually the thing that's generating all the data that goes and populates this panel right here. So introspection is a really easy way to go and fetch a remote schema and provide it as one of our stitching targets. We just need to go and give it the executor that we're using so that it can go and talk to that subservice and pull it in. A few caveats on introspection, one being that introspection can be disabled on some servers, and so you need to make sure that your service is going to enable introspection so that we can actually get this data, otherwise it won't be available. And the other one would be introspection does not include custom directives. So if your schema is sensitive to including custom directives, introspection is probably not the solution for you. We've got an alternate solution that we'll look at next here. So anyways, using introspection and giving it the executor of the service that we want to talk to, Introspection will bring in the schema, plug it in here. We give it an executor so that when the stitching operations need to go and talk to this specific service for data, they know how to do so. And that schema is in, product schema. Here's the storefront schema. So the storefront's executor we're going to do slightly differently. So this is taking a different approach here where I've set up this fetch remote SDL method. And this is a really simple function that I wrote down here. Basically, it's just going and performing a query to the remote. I'm passing in the storefront's executor, and I'm saying, okay, run a query for something called SDL. And if we look at the implementation here, you can see, in the storefront schema, there's this SDL field, which is a string. And if you look at how I've built the schema here, we've actually got type defs are being read from that GraphQL schema file, and type defs are being built into this schema, and they're also being served as an SDL root field. So if we actually wanted to go to our storefronts schema, we could request SDL. And you can see there it is. Okay, so this thing is just returning a string of the SDL that it builds itself with. So this is really useful because we can go and build our own string that includes things like custom directives, and it can't be disabled by introspection. And by using that kind of self-hosted service, we can fetch our complete SDL using our own protocol, return that, and then using the GraphQL helper method build schema, we can just build that SDL string into a schema and give it the remote executor. And this schema is now ready to go. So then for this one down here, we're talking again about how this Rainforest API, a hypothetical product database that we don't own, this here is going to have a conflicting type. Again, we're actually looking at the same product's service and just posing it as a third party, but it's going to have a conflicting product type inside of it and a conflicting product query. And so if we wanted to reconcile that inside of our Stitch gateway, we can use this idea of transforms. And so transforms let you do all kinds of handy and unique things, where we actually go and transform the schema in ways that doesn't actually affect the underlying subschema. Basically, it's just a layer of adding proxies, proxy transforms, so that we're talking to our GraphQL gateway using these names, and then it's talking to a remote service using that service's own names. So in this case, all of the types inside of this Rainforest's API, I'm going to prefix with Rainforest, and then all of the root fields, I'll do the same thing, prefix those with Rainforest. And so if we go back to our Stitch gateway up here, you can see that we are still talking, each of these, the product method and the Rainforest product method, are both talking to the same underlying service, getting the same underlying data, but we've just named it something different in this Rainforest's flavor of it, so that we can go and be incorporating this API without naming conflicts. That concludes this first installment of combining local and remote schemas. All the notes and sample code are in this repo here. I'll include a link to that with the video, and in future installments we'll discuss how overlapping types between schemas can be reconciled. More then.